How you doing? How you doing?
Sir, I'm sorry, you missed your intro.
No, I'm just flanking you. You know, I ought to keep everyone. Please, folks, sit down. Yeah, so Paul, I guess we're a little bit light headwinds as we're coming from the East Coast out to the Midwest here. So how are you all doing this morning? Ooh. All right. Well, first of all, congratulations for being selected to come here to take part in this. It's a great way to start off your military career by being selected amongst your peers as somebody who's not only met the standard but exceeded the standard, and somebody that's noteworthy enough to represent your school organization in a large gathering like this. There's always a lot of responsibility that comes with being selected to represent a larger group that you're part of, because now most of the people that you're interfacing here with, they won't have a chance to meet the rest of your school or your company or regiment or wherever you're from West Point. And so what they do is they will talk with you, they will speak with you, and then they will sort of pass judgment on the rest of your organization based upon what they've seen with you. Well, that's going to continue your entire time in the Army, because you're going to run into a lot of people who don't have or have very little contact with soldiers. You will go around the world and you'll interface with people who have had probably very little contact with Americans. And based upon how they interact with you and what their impressions are, either you as a soldier or you as an American, they will then extrapolate, well, I guess all soldiers are like this. I guess all Americans are like this. So it's a great way to start off understanding the responsibilities of representing the organization you're from, because while you're in the military, for one thing, you stand out because you're dressed like you are. You can take a look at your patches and pins, and people can easily see not only who you are, but they can see where you're from. They can see what unit you are, what rank you are, sort of like that, and they can quickly make associations that as you're if you're dressed in a casual suit, it's pretty hard to do. So I think everybody here is going to be graduating here in a couple months, correct? Yes, yes. West Point is too. You are all firsties. Yes. All right. How from ROTC, how many have heard me speak before? How many maybe this summer at Knox? Okay, some. So I'll try not to repeat too much of it. So it'll look like maybe about 25%. A couple of things I want to talk about as you all sort of embark upon entering into the officer corps and being lieutenants, and what's going to be expected of you, and regardless of what school you're at or what pre-commissioning source you've gone through, we've spent a large amount of time, invested a large amount of resources, not the least of which is time and energy of the staff and faculty and the folks that ran the various training venues you went to, and we may have sent you around the world to a CTLT-like or other kind of broadening experience. And we're doing that to prepare you for something. It's not just that we had a lot of extra cash and time on our hands, and so I figured, well, you know, we'll just blow it on you and send you all these kinds of experiences that are very expensive, because we know that you are going to have a lot of challenges come your way. Now, usually as I talk to folks as they're about to be commissioned, or actually as they're about to go into any new job, tomorrow I'm going to talk at the pre-command course here at Fort Leavenworth. It's where we have all of the battalion commanders and brigade commanders before they take command. They come here to Fort Leavenworth and they spend a couple of weeks, and we run them through sessions, and we do that every month, because there are a lot of battalion and brigade commanders in the Army, and active duty folks, Guard, Reserve, and we run them through here and have a lot of training venues for them, and a lot of folks talk to them. So I'll be talking to them tomorrow. And in many ways, they're like you, okay, because they have never been a battalion commander before. They have never been a brigade commander before. And just like you, have never been an officer before. You've never been a platoon leader before. They have certain amount of sort of anxiety. Gosh, what's the Army expecting me to be a brigade commander? What's the Army expecting me to be a battalion commander? What's the Army expecting of me to be a lieutenant? So that's common. And that will never go away because we're always going to pretty much give you a job that you've never had before. That's how things work in the Army. And one of the things that we're going to expect of you is that eventually you'll do that job very well. But it's kind of a tiered process, okay? I'd never been the TRADOC commander before. They made me the TRADOC commander. So I'm thinking, hey, where's the TRADOC pre-command course that I can go to so I can talk to somebody to get me up to speed? Found out there wasn't one. So then your whole self-development domain kicks in. I've talked to a lot of former TRADOC commanders, just like you're going to talk to some former chiefs of staff of the Army here, former ROTC graduates, and they'll bestow a lot of wisdom on you and scar tissue learning. And so one of the most common things, when I talk to the battalion pre-command course, because the battalion and brigade pre-command course, and what we do in the Army is we are a culture of after-action reviews. We always want to know, sustain and improves. What are we doing well? What are we not doing well? What can we improve on? You know, what do we want to sort of keep the same? And so every time I talk to the pre-command course for the battalion and brigade command course, they do a critique sheet, okay? So you're at West Point or you're at ROTC and you go to math class or English class or you go to your military science class or whatever and you do something and then you get a grade, you get a critique. It doesn't change. When you're a four-star general, you give a briefing, you talk to folks, and they fill out a critique sheet. So sort of just get used to it. That's what we do in the Army. We grade everybody's homework the whole time. And so what I do, trying to be a good professional, I always read the critique sheets. And, you know, more of this, less of this, didn't cover this, want to talk about that. And one of the ones I would get a lot is, I really want a checklist. You know, could you just sort of give me a checklist of what it's going to take to be a successful battalion or brigade commander? Because they're like, hey, sir, you command a battalion, you command a brigade, you command a division, you had a bunch of battalion and brigade commanders below you. We want a checklist. And so after a couple of these critique sheets, I saw the same thing. You know, we sort of want this checklist, kind of like the take-home packet. You know, like the pre-command take-home packet. If I just take these and TRADOC commander said, if I do these 10 things, I'll be guaranteed to be successful. And I said, you know what? Command is not really like that. It's not really a checklist kind of thing, because actually leadership is not like that. It's not really a checklist kind of thing. But there is a way to think about it, and you can't think about it from a checklist point of view, but you do have to think about it from a point of view of how do I get prepared. And so we are all here this week spending time in honoring, and you are being honored in the name of General Retired Marshall. And in fact, right across from here is Marshall Auditorium. General Marshall spent about 5 years here at Fort Leavenworth during his time in the Army. And if you look at his biography, his resume, his experience, it actually is pretty enlightening with regards to what we want you to be able to do when we commission you. Now, you are not going to be commissioned directly as the Chief of Staff in the Army or as the Secretary of State or as the Secretary of Defense, but some of you may get there eventually, okay? And if you take a look at his career, I believe he was commissioned in 1901 from ROTC and then became Chief of Staff in the Army, I think in about 39. Eventually became Secretary of State, and his last official duty, I believe, was Secretary of Defense. Just think about everything that he kind of went throughout his timeline. So became a second lieutenant in 1901, and then, you know, is in the Army through World War I. Then we get to World War II, and if you just think of the differences between those two eras, the huge leap in technology that time, the scale of a global war versus a European war. And then, of course, by the time we end up completing World War II, we end up in the nuclear era. So he's the Chief of Staff of the Army when, you know, the U.S. Army Air Corps drops a nuclear bomb. So just think of when he was commissioned in 1901, when we still had a substantial amount of horse-drawn artillery and horse-riding cavalry and all that. And then we have the age of mechanization and armored forces and aircraft carriers and submarines and eventually ending up with nuclear weapons. So if you look at General Marshall's tenure, he goes from a horse-powered army to a nuclear weapon-equipped army. And that's a pretty dramatic shift, okay? And I am sure as he was about to graduate as a second lieutenant like you all, and if they had some four-star general come talk to him, I mean, even in his wildest dreams, that general probably couldn't say, look, Cadet Marshall, I'm looking to the future, and I know you have very good horsemanship skills right now, but you're really going to have to, you know, bone up on your nuclear physics background, because that will be a weapon that you'll end up using. I mean, you just wouldn't have even made that up. But that probably is going to happen to you all, probably even exponentially. Okay? So, you know, the newest branch in the Army right now, we just stood up this year, is cyber. So that's the cutting edge. That's it. I imagine by the time one of you are Chief of Staff of the Army, cyber will be old hat. You know, there'll be some kind of cyber mechanism we're using today will be in a museum, either here at Leavenworth or something else, you know, like the good old days. And say, gosh, remember when people thought cyber was really important, when they thought cyber was powerful? Look at it now. And so, and that's why, quite honestly, as we prepare you to be commissioned and as we prepare you to be leaders, we can't give you a checklist for everything, okay? And that's why when I talk to folks at the pre-command course, or I talk to you today, you know, I just can't get a long enough checklist. I mean, how long a checklist would General Marshall had to have been given when he graduated that went from horse-drawn artillery to nuclear weapons? You know, impossible. But, and then the other thing, when I talk to a lot of soon-to-be graduates or even battalion commanders, brigade commanders, I also go talk to the course. We'll be bringing all our new generals in. When you become a one-star general, we bring you in and give you a course. And then when you're a two-star general, three-star general, we keep working with you because this is continual, the sort of domain of continual learning. We talk to folks. And one of the things that comes up at every echelon when I talk to folks is kind of, they might not say, they know, okay, I got it, but it's not a checklist, but have I been trained for everything that I'm going to be asked to do? In other words, do I have all the right experiences, et cetera, like that? And I would tell you, no. There is no way we can train you for everything that's going to come your way. We cannot train you for every potentiality that's going to happen out there. So when you get to your first unit and you ask yourself, am I perfectly trained to be a second lieutenant? The answer is no, okay? Because as soon as you get to the first unit, you know what you're going to do? You're going to start training. You're going to be doing all kinds of things. But the question you should ask is not am I perfectly trained to be a lieutenant, but am I well prepared? That should be yes, okay? There's a difference between being perfectly trained and well prepared. We can't train you for everything, but we can prepare you for just about anything, okay? When General Marshall was commissioned as a second lieutenant, he wasn't trained for everything he had to do, but he was well prepared, okay? He was prepared enough that with everything that the Army was going to do with him between 1901 and 1939, that he was prepared enough to become the Chief of Staff of the Army, okay? And deal with nuclear weapons, and then prepared enough to become the Secretary of State and implement the Marshall Plan, and on and on and on. As Winston Churchill referred to General Marshall when he was Chief of Staff of the Army, he was the architect of victory, really, in the European theater. He was the architect of victory. Had, when he was a lieutenant, was he trained to come up with a plan to generate victory at a global scale? No, but he was prepared, okay? And my experience is, as I've served in the Army for a number of years now, is most leaders, when called upon, are actually much better prepared than they think they are. They are much better prepared than they think they are. They are not perfectly trained, but they are much better prepared than they think they are. Now, one of the questions that I get a lot from soon-to-be lieutenants, is very common, is, well, sir, you know, I'm going to go out into my formation, and my formation, everybody in my formation almost has been in the Army longer than I have. definitely my non-commissioned officers. There might be some brand new privates that are coming in out of AIT or OSIT about the same time I come in. But most everybody in my unit has been in the Army longer than I have. And because of where we are in our nation's history now, there are a lot of combat veterans. So that when I go out to my unit, you know, a large number of them will have served in combat, and I will not have served in combat. So how's that going to work? In other words, I may be out there as the least experienced person in my platoon or whatever it is that you're leading as a lieutenant. And then what if we get deployed? What if we get deployed to combat, and I've never been in combat, and everybody else has? How does that work? How's that going to work? I said, it's going to work just like it's always worked in the Army, okay? Because here's the truth. Regardless of how combat experienced you are, regardless of how many tours to Iraq or Afghanistan you've had or wherever you've been, everybody went to combat for the first time somewhere, okay? Nobody just comes into the Army as a combat veteran, okay? Everybody goes to combat for the first time somewhere. Some go early in their careers, some go much later in their careers. But we don't then decide who's going to run the unit by who's been in combat more often. Just as, hey, we're going to our fourth NTC rotation. So today, the person in charge of the unit is going to be the person who's had the most NTC rotations. Who's that? You, oh, okay, you used to be in charge, now you're not because you have less NTC. That's not how the Army works. We don't pick the person who has the most experience at whatever we're doing. Okay, today we're going to clean the motor pool. Who has cleaned the motor pool more than anyone else? You? Okay, boom, you're in charge. You know, not how the Army works, okay? Because what we assume is that if you're in charge, we have prepared you. You may not have all the experience in the world. You may not be perfectly trained, but we think we have prepared you for your role to do whatever it is that we ask you to do. That is a question I get all the time by soon-to-be lieutenants, is the whole, first of all, everybody else in the platoon is more experienced than I am. How does that work? I've never been to combat before. How does that work? Now, back to this whole lieutenant in a platoon thing, the way that works is that's how it is designed, okay? Because, see, everybody in the Army, if you're an officer, pretty much starts out as a lieutenant. And your non-commissioned officer, your platoon sergeant, your right-hand man or woman or whoever it is, they realize that when you show up as a second lieutenant that you are not very experienced and you have very little training. They hope you're well prepared, but they know you have very well training. So they realize part of their job is to assist you in getting that training experience that you don't have. It's not to take over your job, but they know that is their responsibility, is to make sure that now that you're in the operational domain, you are getting trained. That's how the system works, okay? If you show up knowing everything already and are perfectly trained, you're going to ruin this whole thing we got going, okay? Because the way this whole thing works is that we give you a platoon sergeant and we give you a bunch of non-commissioned officers because you're brand new, and what we expect is that you are prepared enough to listen to them, that you are prepared enough to understand the role they play. You understand the role of the NCO. You might not know everything the NCO does, but in your preparation, you know they are the backbone of the Army. You know they have a lot of experience, and then together, you know, they sort of raise everyone's boat there. That's the difference between being prepared and perfectly trained. See, if you show up and you don't listen to your NCOs, if you show up acting like you know everything when we know you don't, that will show that you are not prepared to be a leader. That will be an indication of a lack of preparedness, okay? We know you have a lack of training. We just hope that you are well prepared, okay? And that's generally what your soldiers are looking for. Your soldiers are trying to figure out how prepared are they to be a leader. Not are they perfectly trained to be, you know, an infantry platoon leader, artillery platoon leader, a multifunctional logistician platoon leader. They know you're not perfectly trained, but they do want to know, are you well prepared? And they'll be watching from the first day. Your soldiers will be watching from the first day. And here are the indications in their mind that you are prepared. One of them is they want to know, are you prepared to put your unit before yourself? Are you prepared to do that? Okay? You might not have experience doing it, but are you prepared to do that? Are you prepared to lead from the front? Okay, you may not be the expert at everything, but are you prepared? Are you prepared to learn? Okay, are you going to go around and try to figure out as much as you can from your leaders, from other platoons, from things like that? Have you prepared yourself to learn? Have you prepared yourself to grow? Have you prepared yourself to be a team player? Have you prepared yourself to build teams? That's what they want to know. And if you could put up the ADP 622 leadership logic map. Now, the good deal is, here in training and doctrine command in the Army, so we write doctrine. And doctrine is gives you a way to think about that, about what you are going to do as you lead and fight and win our nation's wars as a leader in the United States Army. And we have a manual for all the things that we think are very important. And we have one titled Army Leadership, because we think it's very important. And this is the logic map of ADP 622, which is our leadership manual. And what we have in the front of the manual, you can see they're only about 10 pages long, is kind of a Cliff Notes version to begin with in the front, and it kind of condenses some of the things that we want to say in the book and contextualizes them relative to other things. And what we've done, and we have a lot of experience and analysis on that, when we take a look at leadership, we say there's two major categories, attributes and competencies, okay? And the attributes are what we want you to be and know, okay? In other words, I want you to be a warrior. I want you to be fit. I want you to know what it takes to be an expert in your particular field. I want you to know how to be agile, etc. This is about you, what I want you to be and know. But then it's not only adequate that you have personal attributes, you must array them in time and space and then actually do something with them. You must do something with the attributes that we've worked so hard to embed in you. Therefore, if there's English majors out there, you can correct my grammar. You must lead, these start with verbs. You must lead others, build trust, prepare self, okay? Develop others, get results. We are not an altruistic jobs program. We are a results-oriented organization. But you must get results while creating a positive command climate. You must get results while leaving your unit better than when you got there. You must get results by making people better than they were than before you led them. Now, what's very interesting about this is, as I said, we're a professional organization. We're always doing AERs, and every year out here, the Center for Army Leadership here at Fort Leavenworth, this proponent for leader development, does a survey, the CASL. What that CASL survey does is it has folks in the Army grade the Army's homework on leadership. How are we doing on leadership? And has a bunch of questions, et cetera. And we query from E4 to Colonel. E4 to Colonel. We don't really care what generals think anymore. But E4 to Colonel. So you'll be getting one of these probably next year. You may. I don't think we do cadets. And we ask a bunch of questions, okay? Last year we had 30,000 respondents, 30,000. And any of you are ORSA folks out there, you'll know when you, and this is the era of elections in our nation, you know, you see all these Gallup polls and things like that, you know, about for people who's running ahead in the polls and all that. If you take a look at most sample size, they're like 400 to 800. 800 is actually a large sampling. So it's 400 to 800 when they do these presidential election polls. This was 30,000. That's a huge sample size. And some pretty interesting feedback comes back. This is feedback from the soldiers that you are about to lead. So I always pay close attention to it. And very interesting feedback. The feedback I pay most attention to is kind of the last question. And what that question says, hey, in your own words, describe to me the best leader you've ever worked for. So you're a sergeant or something, tell me about the best lieutenant you've ever worked for, best platoon leader you've ever worked for. The part that makes it actually so interesting is I know, unlike you all, since you are about to be commissioned, most people in the Army don't read doctrine every night like you do, right? And I know they haven't memorized it. I know they don't even know we have a manual on leadership. They've never even heard of ADP 622. So they don't even know that there's such a thing as competencies and attributes. So actually, that's what makes the answer all the more surprising. Because I know they don't know that there's even an answer. there's not even a right answer, wrong answer. There's not like an attribute or competency. They're like, hey, they just asked me, tell me the best lieutenant I've ever worked for, so I have no choice but, in my own words, to tell them the best lieutenant I ever worked for. Which actually makes it so interesting to me because they're not trying to, well, I got to have like three attributes and two competencies and blah, blah, that. They're just like, in my own words, from the heart, Lieutenant Smith, XYZ, this is what he or she did that I liked the most. That actually makes the answers all the more interesting because they're not trying to get the right answer. They're just speaking from their heart. And so without knowing that we have categories, the majority of the answers fall into one category. So that's really catches my attention. What do you think that category is? Without even knowing that there is such a thing as categories. The majority of the answers fall into the category of competencies. In other words, what do you do? Why was this lieutenant the best lieutenant you ever worked for? And then what, you know how they answer it? Well, let me tell you what they did, okay? Not necessarily how smart they are, okay? Not necessarily a specific personal attribute, but let me tell you what they did because that's what I paid attention to, okay? Now, we know, for instance, down here, to lead others and to lead by example, you must be fit. But what they're saying is, I don't really care if my lieutenant had the highest PT score in the platoon. What I cared was he helping the rest of us? Was he developing others? I didn't really care if my lieutenant knew everything there was about artillery. I didn't really care if he was the best artilleryman out there. But what I want to know is, did he engender trust in the platoon? Did he lead by example? Now, we know from experience and study, you have to have threshold levels of this. If you aren't fit, you can't lead from the front. If you don't have a basic level of expertise, then you can't lead by example, etc. like that. But what they're saying is, what I really grade people on is what they do. It's what they do, okay? Now, you need to understand this because you're at a transition point here, and we haven't always done it well in the Army. And you're at a critical transition point. And so a couple of years ago, maybe when you first came into ROTC or West Point, there were some headlines in the Army Times about toxic leadership and excessive toxic leadership and all these various things like that. And it was from our own studies. It wasn't some investigative reporter. They went on the CASA website, and these surveys I'm telling you about were saying, hey, we have too many toxic leaders in the Army, et cetera, like that, et cetera, et cetera. And we started, okay, let's take a look at that. Why is that? Okay, up until now, okay, all of you, West Point, ROTC, doesn't matter. What have we kind of been grading you on? Been grading you on attributes, right? We've been pretty much grading on your attributes. What's your GPA? What's your OML? What's your PT score? What's your rifle score? What's yours? Okay? And then all made an OML, and you all got your first choice, I heard, a branch location. Right? Yes? How you define first choice, I guess. And so what we started looking at ourselves, we said, you know what? As we bring folks into the Army, we focus an awful lot on grading personal attributes. Okay? And then we wanted, you know what? As we brought this person to the Army, we focused a lot on their personal attributes, them. And now how is it that we have an excessive number of self-absorbed leaders? How could that possibly be? Well, maybe we're building them. Okay, maybe as you sow, so shall ye reap. And so we've taken a look at General Combs and Cadet Command and General Caslin at West Point and in our basic training and all that. We said, you know what? It's not to do away with one of the others, but we need to balance these. Because very much to you all, as you've gone through your commissioning source, we have really focused on your attributes. Now, part of that is by design because we've been preparing you, okay? We've been preparing you to be a lieutenant. What you have to understand is part of your preparation now, and now you've been focused on yourself for a while. I mean, you've probably been in leadership positions, all that, but you've really focused a lot on yourself, your studies, your preparation for commissioning, et cetera. You're about to go through a very dramatic shift, and it has nothing to do with you're going to start wearing a different uniform and you're going to PCS someplace, something like that. The dramatic shift is that the expectation of the Army is that we expect that you spend very little time worrying about your personal self, and you spend the majority of your time doing stuff for others. You spend most of your time leading by example, developing others, continuing to prepare yourself. Prepare yourself, okay? So up until now, we have spent a lot of time preparing you. We give you a PMS, we give you a tactical officer, we send you to summer training, we do a lot of stuff. We have been preparing you for a lot. Go here, shoot this rifle, take a PT test, on and on and on. We have invested a lot in you, okay? So the institution has been preparing you for 4 years plus, depending upon where you are in your life cycle. Now we're saying, this, the tides are turning. On average, we have prepared you for 4 years to do this job. This is the last, you are the most prepared to do this job than you will any other job in your career, okay? We are not gonna spend four more years preparing you to do anything. This is as good as it gets. Okay? This is as good as you get, so enjoy it. You've got a couple more months to relish it, okay? Because we're never going to spend four more years preparing you for anything, okay? You're going to hit the thing that's going to start rolling. But the good news is, if we have done, because what we're doing now is we're tired. General Combs and I mean, we need a break. We're preparing you for 4 years now, okay? We're taking the weekend off. Actually, I'm not, but we're taking the weekend off, and you know what we're doing? We're taking our inbox, and we're dumping it into your inbox. Because now it's about preparing self. Now we're saying, hey, look, you need to pick up the slack here, okay? I know you haven't been kicking back, but what we're saying is the expectation of the Army is you've got to develop a way to self-prepare yourself all the time. And we're going to start giving you jobs that you may have never even heard of before. And you may have a very small amount of time to get ready for them. But the good news is, historically speaking, folks have done very well on that. So I'll give you a couple of quick war stories here, just because war stories are more interesting than me talking about doctrine anyways, to kind of put that in perspective about our expectations and delineating being well prepared versus being perfectly trained. And so a number of years ago, this happened to be April of 2003, there was a young lieutenant, okay, and he had been commissioned the year before, so he'd been not actually quite a year out. And so he had been actually luckily well prepared, not perfectly trained, but very well prepared for what was going to happen, he thought. And so it was kind of like the George C. Marshall kind of thing. You come into one world, and then the world changes very quickly. Now, he didn't go from horse-drawn, you know, artillery to nuclear weapons, but in his world as a lieutenant, it's kind of like that. And so he was commissioned, and then he goes off at this point to the Armor Basic Course, and he's a tank platoon leader doing that. And you have to understand, he was commissioned before 9/11. So, you know, before 9/11, the two big things you do is go to the National Training Center to do that. You'd go to gunnery, you'd do various things like that. And those were kind of the metrics on the wall. Then, of course, 9/11 happens. So, again, when he was a cadet, would anybody in their wildest dreams have said, hey, you know what's going to happen right after you graduate? So he graduated in the May time frame and, of course, September 11. So within the 6 months after you graduate, you know, the United States is going to be attacked, of which the result will be more casualties in Pearl Harbor. World Trade Centers will come crumbling down. Manhattan will be covered, you know, in a foot of dust, et cetera, like that. I mean, would he have made that up? Was that on his final exam? You know, what are you going to do when the continental United States is attacked 6 months after you graduate? Did any of you have that during your summer problem when you're out training at Fort Knox? No, you didn't have that, Six Lanes. Okay, well, this cadet didn't have it either, okay? But that's what happened, okay? And then all of a sudden, his life changes like everyone else of our lives. He goes through a training program, et cetera, like that, and goes on and on. And so he finds himself, you know, shortly after that, within a year, finds himself in Kuwait and leading a tank platoon. And so one thing leads to another, and now it looks like they're going to invade Iraq. And so he gets in his tank platoon, they invade Iraq, and the battle goes on and on and on, and they get up to a point of where the city of Baghdad is going to be invaded, okay? Now, do you think like in Armor Basic or when he was at pre-commissioning, they had done sand tables on, okay, now, everybody, the next time you invade Baghdad, remember, here's all the streets are, here's the bypass, here's the little trail that goes around to the left. You know, he'd never been to Baghdad before. Had never really even kind of in his mind had a what, like, okay, what is the TTP for invading a city of 6 million people, Lieutenant? You know, didn't you do that six lanes in your summer training? No, he hadn't. But we're banking on the fact that he's well-prepared. And so one thing leads to another, and this lieutenant finds himself as the lead platoon leader of the lead tank platoon invading Baghdad, okay? So you have this lieutenant, a lieutenant, who's in the lead tank of the lead platoon, of the lead company, of the lead battalion, of the lead brigade, of the only division, of the whole ground combat assault going into Iraq that is the main effort of the division, the main effort of the Corps, the main effort of the CFLIC, which is the main effort of CENTCOM, which is the main effort of the United States of America. So you have the lead person of the main effort of the United States of America is a very well-prepared, yet not perfectly trained, lieutenant. And all bets are on him, okay? Because they are attacking in a single file with a lieutenant at the front who, just shortly before that, could have been sitting right here before 9/11 thinking, hey, where am I going on my summer vacation, okay? Now, as this lieutenant, who's the lead platoon leader of the lead tank, who's the main effort of the United States, is attacking into Baghdad. Had never really rehearsed that before, quite honestly. Is on this highway. And the enemy puts off these concrete jersey barriers, you know, like the big kind of construction concrete barriers up there. They're trying to stop this onslaught of a heavily armored force. And this lieutenant was in an M1 tank. It was a plow tank. It's got a mine plow on it because they had gone through some minefields, and so he was in a tank that had the mine plow on it, and this is a plow to turn up mines and flip them over. So it's this big mine plow thing out in front of the tank. And so he's screaming down the highway with an entire armor brigade behind him. He's the lead tank, single file. And they're coming, and then here's this big concrete barrier that had been moved up there, and he's moving upon it at a high rate of speed. Now, this was an unfamiliar scenario to him, to say the least. An unfamiliar, untrained scenario, but he was pretty well prepared. Now, I've spoken with him later. It's interesting what's going through his mind. And so he's trying to do the whole, you know, his, I don't know, freshman physics is trying to come back into his mind, kind of like, you know, F equals MA, force equals mass times acceleration. Got a lot of mass here. A lot of mass here is a tank. I need to generate some force, so I guess I need to accelerate. We, you know, everyone's under pressure. We can't second guess at this point in time. So he's like, okay, I can stop, but then what? Then I stop to become a target, and kind of like that. And so he has two options: either stop and deal with that, or just get as much acceleration as possible. And he chose the latter because he figured, well, it's a big tank, you know. I mean, concrete tank. Hopefully, it's going to win out. So as his driver, hey, you need to, you know, step on the gas, get some acceleration velocity, 1/2 mv², kinetic energy, for all you physics majors out there. And so the driver does exactly like the LT said, and he steps on the gas, and they slam into this concrete barrier going about 30 miles an hour, okay? If you slam into anything going 30 miles an hour, that's a pretty dramatic shift in momentum, okay? Now, a tank's got a lot of momentum behind him. Well, what happened was, in his mind, he thought the concrete was going to pulverize. Not exactly. Okay, this is reinforced concrete. It was a barrier, okay? But what did happen is the plow there, and if you've ever been around a tank plow, they're very stout instruments. The plow just bent up like this. And so when it bent up like this, it kind of created like a little jump, and the tank hits the concrete barrier, the top of it kind of shatters, the plow bends up, and it sends the tank airborne. So the tank goes flying in the air, I mean like 5 or 6 feet, but that's high for a tank, okay? And it goes flying over this thing, comes back down, and the rear end of it kind of clips the concrete barrier, and kind of more stuff shatters, and kind of lands on the other side. Now, when it landed on the other side, the lieutenant's face slammed in the 50 cal mile, broke his nose, blood everywhere, et cetera, like that. But it landed, and it was still operational. I mean, you know, a few things kind of broke off in the inside. The blade's not like it used to be, but it can move, shoot, and communicate. Well, that had a dramatic effect on a lot of people, okay? The first people had an effect on were the Iraqi defenders on the other side, having had some of them be captured and talked to them. And they were there, and they had RPGs and anti-tank missiles and everything like that. And they thought for sure this barrier was going to stop, I mean, anything that came down the road, as you would think. It's a huge concrete barrier. And then their plan was it would stop, and then when it stopped, they were out of a hail of anti-tank guided missiles and everything like that. But it didn't stop because the lieutenant went flying over the barrier. And so what it had was a huge psychological impact on them. They're like, you know, the kind of the dust clears. You can imagine all the dust is there, and the tank clears, and they're like, these guys are crazy. You know, I mean, these Americans are serious dudes. You know, anybody that would do that is probably really going to be somebody who is, you know, leading from the front, okay, is pretty resilient, definitely displaying warrior ethos, okay, and got results, okay? And so what a lot of them did, they just said, hey, forget this, and literally, like, dropped their kit and ran, because they said, you know, they could look down the highway and say, there's a whole brigade of these nuts down there, you know? And so if this is what the first one's going to do, God knows what the next ones are capable of doing. So I had a huge psychological, it really made, it communicated quite a lot. It communicated the warrior ethos, okay, of that formation. Probably more importantly, the tank right behind him had his wingman in it, who unfortunately, about 2 miles back, had just been killed. Okay, so the tank right behind him had his wingman in it, and the wingman up, the tank commander up in the turret had been killed. And so his crew had to remove him from the turret and put him in the floor of the tank. And then the gunner of that tank had to pop up and become the tank commander. So let's think about the situation inside the tank behind him. There's a tank behind him, and I will tell you that tank commander was exceptionally well thought of and admired. And now their beloved tank commander is basically dead on the floor of the tank with what you can imagine was the inside of that vehicle it looked like as he was hit with a 50 cal type weapon while he was up in the TC's hatch. And so that young sergeant had to take his beloved tank commander and take him out of that position and just lay him on the floor of his tank. And that sergeant then had to climb up in that TC's hatch. You know what? He had never been trained to be a TC. That gunner had never been trained to be a TC. That lieutenant had never been trained, okay, how to deal with assaulting into a city of 6 million people and dealing with a concrete barrier. But you know what is common between that lieutenant and that sergeant? They were both fully prepared to do it. They were not perfectly trained, but they were fully prepared, okay? Because you know what that sergeant did? And I spoke to him afterwards. He says, you know what? I watched what that lieutenant did. I watched what that lieutenant did. Because here's a kid who's been in tank commander for about 20 minutes. Okay. Here's a kid who's been tank commander for about 20 minutes with his previous tank commander dead, lying next to him. And he said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do what the lieutenant did. Because, see, what they grade you on is what you do. Okay. They grade you on what they didn't say, you know what? I wonder what that lieutenant's GPA was, and then I'll figure out whether I'll follow him or not. Now, I'm not saying don't have a good GPA. I'm not, you know, I used to teach at the college level, so I'm all about that. But what I'm saying is those surveys that we get all the time, my experience is they are pretty accurate. They are pretty accurate about what everybody grades people's homeworks on. I give you that example to show how powerful your influence is, because again, what your soldiers want to know is what are you prepared to do? Okay, what are you trained to know, what are you prepared to do? Because see, once they determine what you are prepared to do, then they'll probably do the same thing. That is what is so really awe-inspiring about the responsibility that comes with leadership. Because our soldiers give us the benefit of the doubt. Our soldiers give us the benefit of the doubt, and they say, you know what? Whether you went to RTC, whether you went to West Point, we think you are very well prepared. We know you're not perfectly trained, but we think you are very well prepared. And pretty much whatever you do, that's what we're going to do. Whatever you do, we think is the standard. And especially if I've never done it before, especially if it's life or death situation, especially if it's very complex and there's not a checklist. Because I told you, we can't make a checklist for what you do. So the problem with your soldiers is, that when I say a problem, the challenge you have responsibility, the more complex the situation, the more life and death hangs in the edge, I have found the more often your soldiers are going to do what you do, because they look across their platoon and they say, you know what? He or she may not be the best trained, but we think they're the best prepared. We think they are the best prepared to make those hard calls. What I'd like to do is spend just a little bit of time to open up to any questions, concerns, good ideas. We're always looking for good ideas. Yes, sir. Yeah, sort of the forcing function. Oh, that's a great point. That is actually a great point. You're not even a plant, are you? No, you have to tell me. Okay, go ahead, sit out. Yeah, Yeah, so the question was, so what's the forcing function? How do we make sure this happens? Well, if in the Army that I grew up in, if you took a look actually at our NCOs, OERs, and stuff like that, they tend to be very attribute-centric. Okay, they tend to be very attribute-centric. If you look at our new OERs, NCOs, leader development doctrine, FM 622, AO manual called Leader Development. You know what it talks a lot about? A lot about competencies. So what we've done is exactly what you did. We have changed our doctrine. This is our doctrine on leader development. This is now, you can go to Wikipedia sites, it's Living Doctrine, and what you can do is go on there and get vignettes of staff sergeants who are in Afghanistan, leaders in Iraq or whatever. And what they do is they will talk you through a scenario somewhat similar than I talked about with regards to, hey, here's how great leaders I've worked with, how they exemplified this doctrine. Here's how it manifests itself. So we've actually changed everything since, so this came out first. This is our doctrine. So we are a doctrine-based army. So we rewrote our doctrine on leadership, saying this is what right looks like. We redid our officer efficiency reports. We redid our non-commissioned officer efficiency reports. And we put out a whole new manual called Leader Development, FM 622. And whenever we have the Marshall Seminar, the TRADOC commander personally comes out and talks to all the folks. All right? So you're the firewall right here, folks. Great question, though. But that's a good point, because professional organizations don't just talk about stuff. They do stuff. So if you want something done, you do it. I talked a lot about this in the pre-command course. You have to have forcing functions. You can get up, you know, in a beautiful auditorium here, Eisenhower Hall, and you can talk about stuff, but you've got to put something in place to make it happen. And so we've changed our rating systems. We've changed our doctrine. And then I come talk to you all. I talk to every pre-command course. I'm sure General Combs and HERS leaders talk about this. And so these things don't happen overnight. Okay, so now part of this, so here's what you have to do. Okay, so now you are prepared. You know the doctrine. We have prepared you. You now have to go out and show your competency. You have to lead by example on that 622. Lead by example. Build trust, all that. You have to say, because you know what? Your soldiers are going to say, well, cadet, well, now Lieutenant XYZ, they just came out of ROTC. They just came out of West Point. They must have the Noah's doctrine. They must be exemplifying what a good leader looks like. So, you know, I'm putting all my eggs in your basket. Other questions? That's a great question. Yeah, back there. Number one. Go ahead.
Sir, Cadet Lavecchi, Campbell University. You often hear about how leaders are making decisions based on making sure they answer their boss, and you often hear that things are more political in nature as you become higher in rank. In your experience, have you balanced answering your boss and ensuring the mission is accomplished while also ensuring that the welfare of your soldiers is maintained?
Yeah, so I was at a captain's career course last week. I got that same question. So first of all, I'll say it's not a balancing act. Second of all, and I know you didn't mean this, so you said as you get higher in rank, there's more pressure to be politically correct. And so I'm kind of at the top end of that scale there. So by that, if you took that assumption to be true, then all I do is give politically correct answers. I know you didn't mean that. I will honestly tell you, and I don't say this to be overly defensive as a senior leader in the Army. I've been in the Army a long time, okay? And I've been in every kind of situation you could possibly imagine. Good days, bad days. I tell folks, I've never had a bad job in the Army. I have worked for some people I never want to work for again, but I've never had a bad job. And I have never had to choose between doing something, I don't know, that I thought pressured to versus taking care of my soldiers. It was never ever a choice for me. I never had to say, well, this is going to be bad for the soldiers, but I just got to suck it down and do it to get promoted. I know it's easy for you to say, well, yeah, you got 4 stars, so, you know, you can say that. But I can tell you, it's just never a choice. I don't even think of things that way. What you do have to do is you have to understand the environment that you're in. You have to understand, and a lot of times when people think, whether it's about leadership or mission command or whatever, it means there's an absence of constraints, that you're not constrained by budget or percent personnel manning or force structure or whatever it is. No, perfect leadership has nothing to do with absence of constraints. It's understanding the constraints and then looking at the constraints and saying, okay, here's the best way to deal with it. But it's always, how do I get the mission done? And in the process of that, taking care of soldiers. I never have to sacrifice one for the other. What I find some people are not as good as they need to be, is being able to articulate what their recommendation is and make it clear to the person they're talking to, one, how it is possible within the constraints they have, plus at the same time, how it could really benefit soldiers and families and how the other course of action could have a downside to it. So last week, with the chief, staff of the Army, and the vice, and all the other 4 stars, and we happen to be working through aviation force structure, how many Apaches do we have, where are they, everything like that. And those are very expensive things, okay? Apaches are very expensive trained pilots, etc. like that. So their recommendations, hey, we should have this and this and this, and the recommendations should always have more. And the issue isn't that more is not better. You know, it's like the AT&T commercial, right? More is better. I want, you know, faster, better, this. Of course, I get a bunch of four-year-olds together and say, is more of these helicopters better or less better? More is better. I got that, you know. And they haven't even been to Command General Staff College yet. And those first graders would say, sir, more is better. That wasn't the issue. The issue is, well, how are you going to pay for these things? Okay? And if I get more of these, we only have a set amount of money, that means I'm going to have less of these. Or I can't train this. We got more pilots, they just fly less often. Well, I don't know. I mean, that's one of the choices. We only have so many flying hours in the Army, so if I have more of them, That means each person has less hours. So they, if you say, well, the fact that you didn't go up there and just say more, you're not taking care of soldiers, that's not understanding the situation. Because it's balancing the resources. It's not balancing political correctness versus taking care of soldiers. It's that sometimes the best way to take care of soldiers is you're making hard decisions with constrained environments and constrained resources. You are always going to have constrained resources. You will never have all the time you want, money you want, people you want. And so what leaders have to do is you have to articulate the benefit and the cost of your recommendation within the context of accomplishing the mission and taking care of soldiers. So I, again, with the possible appearance of sounding defensive here, I don't know of anybody in the Army, and I know just about every general in the Army, that ever wants somebody to say something because it's the right thing to say and not lay it out. I think it's just people love to say that on blogs and all that generally because they don't understand the full context of what they're saying. But I can tell you, I spent a lot of time in very long, drawn-out, bloody meetings at the Pentagon and everything like that, and there's nobody. Political correctness is the last thing I would categorize any meeting that I've been in. People are there really making very strong cases for stuff, but the fact of the matter is there's a limit on what we can do, what we can buy, et cetera, like that, and it's making those hard choices. So I would like to say, during your career, I would be very surprised if that's a constant challenge you have between doing the right thing for soldiers and doing what's politically correct. What you have to be able to get good at is contextualizing your recommendation in a way that resonates with the person you're talking to say, do you understand the impact this is going to have? Do you understand the opportunity cost? If I spend 5 hours doing this, that's 5 hours I can't spend doing this. And I find sometimes people, I'm just going to follow my sword to make a point of this versus trying to describe what I want to do. And that's as much as a cop-out as not doing anything. I'll tell you right now. Oh, yeah, I really expect that person because they just resigned and they made a big deal about it and they fell on the sword, all that. In my mind, that's the easy way out. You know what the more difficult way is? Sit down, try to figure out options, et cetera, like that. If there's a real ethical issue, like, I mean, this person is just unethical, they're going to force me to lie or something like that, yeah, do that. But people that are kind of quick to shoot from the hip, make a rash judgment, not take the time to understand the problem, not take the time to come up with reasonable recommendations that are actually feasible and can be executed, and then build a team and lead it and try to get it done. And in other words, just come in, fly off the handle, fall on the sword and leave. I'm like, well, another lazy person. Because that other thing that I talked about takes a lot of time and effort. You know what it takes? It takes a lot of humility. Somebody who's going to sit down and work through the hard process of come up with solutions, try to build a coalition, everything like that, then you know what? You know they're not in it for themselves. They're not trying to make a headline for themselves. They are really trying to square the Army away. They're trying to really take care of their soldiers. And that is somebody who's prepared to be a leader. Do we have like the official last question? We're there. One more. Okay, that wasn't it. You've all asked really good. Yes, sir, right here.
Sir, Cadet Balfour from Hofstra University, New York. My question is, what have you learned to value most being a TRADOC commander?
What I've learned the most about being the TRADOC commander? The one thing that continually I come to grips with and figure out how we work around it, and most people in the Army, and I really didn't understand it till I got to this level, I mean, I understood it more and more and more, is the scale and complexity of the United States Army. The scale and complexity of the United States Army. And I say that, especially to you all as young leaders, I think it's important for you to understand this, because what I have learned is why things that when I was a lieutenant that seemed to be so clear, I don't know why the Army doesn't do this. I mean, it's just obvious to me. Anybody in their right mind would do this, but they didn't do it. You know, they just didn't listen to Lieutenant Perkins. Now I found out that there's a little bit more to it, okay? And the one word I use is scale. Whenever I talk about the United States Army, the first word I use is scale. Not to say that an idea that somebody's bringing forth is not maybe a good idea, but what I'm saying is you have to contextualize it. You have to understand the scale of the United States Army. And I really did have a good appreciation for it. Somewhat as a three-star, but I probably day in and day out are constantly running into my brick wall as the scale of the Army when we're trying to get things done and how long it takes to do things. But let me put it in perspective so that you can understand this as you kind of go forth en route to becoming Chief of Staff of the Army. The current Chief of Staff of the Army is a ROTC graduate. The one before him is a West Point graduate. So you all have a chance out there. So Tradoc is a proponent for leader development in the United States Army. And so I was going around to these Fortune 500, Fortune 50 companies trying to get good ideas on leader development, the big companies that you're probably very familiar with that, you know, are kind of seen as paragons of developing people and cutting edge. I was talking to one COO once, and he said, yeah, our CEO is really into leader development. In fact, he interviews everybody the company hires and finds out about them, put a round peg in a round hole, et cetera, like that. I said, well, that's a great way to show commitment to that, and it's commendable, et cetera. So that's why I started thinking about, you know, scaling up to the Army. So one of the things Tradoc does is we run recruiting command. You know, when you go around the United States, you see Armed Forces recruiting centers at all the strip malls, and then there's an Army one. You look at that, say, oh, that's Tradoc. So Tradoc Recruiting Command, Major General Jeff Snow, we recruit the United States Army. I don't know if any of you have been in recruiting command prior service. You know how many people the United States Army recruits every year? Last year, active guard and reserve, 132,000 people. Okay, that's over 10,000 people a month. Okay, so we hire 10,000 people a month. So the Chief of Staff of the Army is going to interview everybody we hire. He better get on it. And of course, if he takes a month off, you know, that's 20,000 next month. So let's just think about that. We hire 10,000 new people every month. Okay, and so if we hire 10,000 people a month, what do we do with them? They're not just hanging out like in the Army lobby, right? They got to go to training. They got to go to basic training. They got to go to Bullock. They got to go on and on and on. Last year at Fort Jackson, we run basic training in four locations. Tradoc runs it. Last year at Fort Jackson, we ran 60,000 people through basic training in one post. 60,000 people through basic training. We replicate ourselves to the tune of 10,000 people a month. And so when people, we're 1.2 million people organization, United States Army. So when somebody comes to me and says, hey, you know what? I don't know why the Army doesn't do this. Okay, I was at a human resource seminar once, and people that do human resource, everything like that, talking. I was talking to this one gentleman who has a job that I'd love to have. So he's in charge of human resources for the city of Aspen, Colorado. I'm thinking, hey, that sounds like a great retirement job for me. I love to ski, live out of Aspen, runs that. And so he runs their human resource development or section, does all that. So we're talking about, you know, talent management and development, everything like that. So we're talking, he says, well, I said, how many people do you hire out of Aspen? He goes, 8. I said, like every month? He goes, no, a year. Last year we hired 8 people for the city. 8. I said, I hired 10,000 a month. A month, every month. He's like, 10,000 a month. And so I'm getting all these ideas, which are great ideas, if you hire 8 a year. If you're hiring 10,000 a month, you know, you probably have to have a different paradigm, a different model. And that sort of goes on and on and on with regards to everything the Army does. So we're working right now on gender integration, opening up our combat arms to female soldiers. So we're working very closely with the United States Marine Corps because we have infantry, they have infantry, we have armor, they have armor, artillery. So it's the closest analogy. But there's also a scale thing there. Do you know that there are more women soldiers in the United States Army than there are Marines in the entire Marine Corps? So if I took every female soldier in the United States Army and put them on a parade field, it's bigger than the entire United States Marine Corps. I love the Marine Corps. They're a great organization. But the scale, when you talk about gender integration, it's apples and oranges. So I can tell you, every time I'm working big things in the Army, trying to change big things in the Army, whether Tradoc is a proponent for gender integration, whether we're working on how we recruit people, leader development, et cetera, like that, you know, if I can't do it 10,000 times a month, it's not going to work in the Army. If I can only do it 8 times a year, sell it to Aspen, you know. But it's not going to work in the Army. And so I always have to step back because sometimes there's a lot of good ideas out there. They're just not feasible for an organization like the United States Army. They just aren't going to work. Doesn't mean they're a bad idea. It means they're not going to work. And so the principle may be the same. So I'm a big first order principle person. Let's take the principle of what you have, but we may actually have to operationalize some different, somehow different. And I would say, as you go into the Army, You need to keep that in the back of your mind, that don't jump to conclusions. The Army is very large and very complex. Well, since that was the last official question, let me leave you with one thing here. So as I told you, you are going to go out soon as a lieutenant, and we'll put you in charge of an organization, and you'll have, you know, non-commissioned officers here, and I told you, you need to be prepared to listen to them, et cetera, like that. And then one of the angst that I get all the time is, you know, NCOs are going to be better trained than I am, and that's true in many areas. That's the plan. That's the program. That's how it's designed. That's why we give you one. But, you know, life is all about metrics, et cetera, like that. And if you say, you know, what does my platoon sergeant expect of me out there? I get that a lot, too. You know, what does my platoon sergeant expect of you? You know what your platoon sergeant really expects of you? Yeah, they want you to be prepared. They want you to be prepared to be developed. They want you to prepare to be developed. And what they really want is they want to be proud of you, okay? They really do. They take ownership of you. They want to be proud of you. They want to call you their lieutenant. They want to do that more than anything else. And one of the things that makes them proud of you is they say, look, I brought this lieutenant in here, and look at where he or she is now. In a few short months, they went from here to here. That actually makes them more proud of you than if you come in perfectly trained, which I don't think many of you are, okay, and or at least thinking you are. That's even worse than actually, you know, maybe, well, whatever, because your folks will pick that up. That's really what they want. They want to be proud of you. They want to claim you, and they want to be able to have a level of satisfaction that they were an integral part of your development. They want to be part of your development. They want to make you better. They don't want you to come in and prove that you are perfectly trained, because we've already told them you're not. So I've already written all your platoon sergeants and said that when you show up, you are imperfectly trained. Okay, so they know it. Not a big secret, so don't try to pull the wool over their eyes. But a lot of things are kind of first order principles, and they never change. They never change, because that's why being prepared for something is much better than being perfectly trained, because being perfectly trained means for one specific thing. Being well prepared means it will kind of transcend an event or something like that. And so when I was a division commander, I had a great command sergeant major, division command sergeant major. And then we were in Iraq together, then I come back and I'm going to go off to do a 3-star job, but he is so good, he goes straight to a 4-star job, which actually he came to TRADOC and was a TRADOC command sergeant major. So he comes to TRADOC, and I get sidetracked into a 3-star job, so I'm doing that 3-star job for a while, and then you know, Army, in its effort to show that it's not a risk-averse organization, decides to make me the TRADOC commander. And so TRADOC sergeant major was already there, you know, and he had been my division command sergeant major. So he is at an event with these brand new 1-star generals. And one of these brand new 1-star generals had been a brigade commander for us in the division in Iraq. So he walks into now, you know, colonel promotable X, Y, and Z, and this colonel goes, hey, he says, I see that, you know, General Perkins could become the TRADOC commander, so you're going to be his sergeant major again. And immediately, sergeant major, now sergeant major of the Army, Daley, sergeant major Daley goes, no. He goes, he's going to be my general. It's not that I'm going to be his sergeant major. He's going to be my general. And so that brigade commander, the next time I saw him, told me, he goes, hey, sir, you know what the sergeant major said? He said that you're going to be his general. And he says, now don't get upset with him with being, you know, disrespectful or anything like that. I said, that's the biggest compliment anyone could give me, to have a command sergeant major claim me. Because in his mind, he's like, you know what? I've been out with TRADOC Perkins. He's never been trained to be a TRADOC commander. He's never been it before. When he comes up here, all I hope is that he's prepared. I know he's not trained, but I hope he's prepared, and I'm already going to claim him. So when I was told that Sergeant Major, who's now Sergeant Major of the Army, Daley said, no, I'm not going to be Perkins' Sergeant Major. He's going to be my general. I said, what bigger compliment can you get on that? Okay. So I don't care if you're a second lieutenant going into a job for the first time, or you're a 4-star general going into a job the first time. What your non-commissioned officer wants to do is to be able to claim you. They want you to be prepared to learn and learn the job, and they want you to improve together with them. And that's all you have to do. That's all you have to do. Now, that's a full-time job. That's a full-time job. And remember, all your other soldiers are going to be paying attention to what you do. They're going to be paying attention to what you do, And it's what you do and how you do it an indication of how well prepared you are. And guess what? I have every confidence in the world that you all are extremely well prepared. Good luck and God bless. Thanks, folks.
Sharing your perspective today. That's our George C. Marshall coin. Ooh. Hopefully you'll put it with the probably thousands that you've had from...
Well, his office is right over there. Well, again, congratulations on being selected. It speaks volumes of your potential, how well prepared you are. And I'm going to hang around with you, I think, for a little bit here, and then we'll see you all tonight and everything like that. So look forward to spending some time with you. Carry on, folks. Thanks. Thanks.
If you look over your right shoulder, you'll see Mr. Ed Hall. He's taking you guys who are going to Eisenhower. So if you're going to Eisenhower, start falling over there on Mr. Ed Hall.